Presenting Dr.Gurunath Parale, a product of prestigious institute PGI Chandigarh, a pioneering cardiologist with more than 25,000 invasive cardiac procedures like angiography and angioplasty, and 1 lakh non-invasive cardiac procedures like echo stress test, excellent academician. Teacher and speaker at various conferences with more than 14 national and international publications. Outstanding clinician and recipient of many fellowships and awards.
Sir, what are cardiac biomarkers? Cardiac biomarkers are substances that get released into the blood when the heart is damaged. And these are detected by various specialized immunoassay methods. Now, what is the basic purpose of different cardiac biomarkers? This is in both ischemic heart disease and heart failure. And they're used for diagnosis, prognosis, and management of individual patient with these conditions. Now, this is a timeline we all know about atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis starts with a stable plaque. That plaque becomes unstable. Then there is a non-total, subtotal occlusion of the coronary artery giving rise to a clinical event, and there is total coronary artery occlusion. The usefulness of biomarkers, that if we can identify this particular stage, a particular stage in the progression of atherosclerosis, then that atherosclerotic plaque can be prevented from progression, or even efforts can be made to regress atherosclerosis and prevent a major coronary event from occurring. Now, in atherosclerosis, you have, these are the different markers, biomarkers available at different stages. This is myeloperoxidase, CRP, and others. Similarly, when there is an event, you have troponin T, troponin N. So at various stages, you have different biomarkers that are available. In heart failure, the biomarkers, one is the biomarkers of hemodynamic load, that is NT-proBNP and BNP, that we will talk in detail later. And these are the others, markers for inflammation or markers for diastolic dysfunction. Now, these are the markers we all know. These are the markers of 21st century. But I'll restrict myself to only few for the want of time, to only some markers where we have robust data, which are commercially available and clinically useful. So we are going to concentrate on today's talk only on these four biomarkers, troponins, high-sensitive troponins, hsCRP, and natriuretic peptide. Now, in coronary artery disease, we know around 1/5 of the patient, 19% of the patients, the coronary event occurs despite absence of conventional risk factors. So there is a big detection gap in coronary artery disease. Despite multiple scores, Framingham, European, Q score, named so many scores, we are still not able to identify an event in nearly 20% of the individuals. And this gap tends, we attempt to fill by using various biomarkers. Now, this is a timeline for our various methods for diagnosis in coronary artery disease. Initially, in 60s, it was chest pain was the only thing which helped us to diagnose ischemic heart disease. Then came ECG later in the 60s. Then AST, that is SGOT, then CK. In 90s, we had troponin. Now we have high-sensitive troponin. Now, this is a release, temporal release profile of different biomarkers. Some are non-specific like myeloperoxidase, myoglobin. Some are very specific like troponin, CKMB. We'll go into that later. Now, what is the ideal biomarker? Ideal biomarker is it should be rapidly released into the blood. It should have high concentration in myocardium, so in blood. Should be specific and sensitive. Should be specific to myocardial tissues. Should remain elevated for long amount of time so we can diagnose. We should not miss it. Then the level should correlate with the prognosis and should also help to assess whether the artery has been successfully reperfused after our interventions. Now, we all know that troponin is definitely superior to CKMB because it has a very high myocardial tissue content. If you compare, the troponin ion has a content 6 times more than CKMB. Troponin T has nearly 10 times more than CKMB. So as a result of this, the blood levels of this is also high, and troponin is more cardiospecific than CKMB. Now this we all know, the temporal release profile of different traditional biomarkers that we are using for diagnosis of acute myocardial infarction. Troponins, they are released after around 4 to 6 hours of the event. Their peak around 24 to 36 hours, and they remain in blood for 1 to 2 weeks. So we have very high concentrations that are available in blood for detection. They are released early, and they remain in blood for quite some time. Also, the temporal profile tells us whether there is successful reperfusion. Because if there is a successful reperfusion, you have a sharp peak. It peaks early and comes down compared to non-perfused patient. So troponins are useful for diagnosis. The levels in blood are high. It is useful for predicting whether there is a reperfusion and also for risk stratification. The troponin values at admission predict the mortality at 30 days. So in short, troponins are the probably near ideal biomarkers. All the criteria of biomarkers which we saw, troponin fits the bill, except perhaps rapid release of blood into myocardium, because it takes 4 to 6 hours for troponins to be detected in blood. Now there are certain non-specific causes also, but most are related to heart, which can increase troponin. Now, common question is troponin T versus troponin I. Now the cutoff value for troponin T is 0.5 micrograms. Cutoff value for troponin I is 2.5 to 3.1, depending upon the different assays that we use. Troponin I is slightly more specific, because troponin T can be positive in chronic renal failure, but troponin I is not positive, usually not released in chronic renal failure. Troponin I returns to baseline in 5 to 7 days, but troponin T remains slightly for more time, that is 10 to 14 days. Troponin T has more prognostic, it predicts mortality at 30 days, while troponin I does not. And because troponin T myocardial content is high, even minor necrosis, as in unstable angina, troponin T can be positive and give prognostic information. Now, I told you the only drawback of troponin is it's released in the blood after 4 to 6 hours. This gap is filled in by high sensitive troponin T. Now, high sensitive troponins, the conventional troponins need a value of 100 to 1000 nanograms per liter in the blood to be detected. While high sensitive troponin can be picked up, the values can be picked up as low as less than 20 nanograms. So high sensitive troponins are, which are specific on myocardium, they can be more useful in early diagnosis of myocardial infarction. Now see here, this is a very useful slide. This tells you that troponins are detected in blood after 4 hours, the conventional troponin. But high sensitive troponin can be detected in as early as 2 hours, even in less than 2 hours. So negative high sensitive troponin on admission, you can virtually rule out acute myocardial infarction. And if it is negative at 2 hours, you can definitely rule out myocardial infarction. Of course, this will be useful when the ECG is non-diagnostic. If the ECG shows myocardial infarction, then naturally for the diagnosis, you don't need troponin. But if you have a typical chest pain, and ECG is non-diagnostic, and if you want to give patient benefit of aggressive intervention, because you know first 6 hours are crucial, both for thrombolysis and primary angioplasty, and you should not miss a myocardial infarction because you don't have a diagnostic ECG. In that case, a high sensitive troponin is the parameter which you can use in that time window to diagnose a coronary event and go ahead with aggressive intervention therapy. High sensitive troponins also have prognostic value in general population. The high sensitive troponin, this has been shown in all subjects, if troponin T is detectable, then their mortality is high. If troponin T is not detectable in coronary artery disease and in general population, if troponin T is not detected in blood, then their prognosis is good. And even the different levels of high sensitive troponin T, they correlate linearly with the survival. So increased value of troponin T in blood increases the mortality over the years. So high sensitivity troponin T are a very useful biomarkers, not only in coronary artery disease, also in general population. So in short, the high risk patient can have a positive high sensitivity troponin T. As myocardial damage goes on increasing, the absolute value of troponins goes on increasing, with large myocardial infarction having as high as 10,000 nanograms of troponins. Coming to the next biomarker is HSCRP is a high sensitive C-reactive protein. Now this is a circulating pentraxin. This is produced predominantly in the liver as a part of acute phase response. This is expressed in the smooth muscles of atherosclerotic arteries. This we know plays a role in immune response, and it is a stable biomarker for a low-grade infection, low-grade inflammation. Remember, its half-life is 19 hours. It is neither consumed nor produced during erection. So inflammatory reaction during infection reaction, it is not produced or released. And ideally, you need to measure it 2 weeks apart, two assays, to know what is the stable value. Because if the value is fluctuating, then that value has no meaning. It should have a stable value over 2 weeks, then only it has some relevance. Other important features are they are stable for a long periods of time, provided there is no inflammation, acute injury, or infection. They does not have a circadian rhythm, not affected by food intake. So you can measure it at any time of the day in fasting or non-fasting conditions. Now, conventional CRP can measure only above 5 milligram per liter, while HSCRP, we have to have measurement less than 5. Now, there are a whole lot of conditions where CRP is elevated, we know. But HSCRP has a particular role, proven role, now we know, in neonatal sepsis, in osteoarthritis, and perhaps now in atherosclerotic coronary artery disease. Now, there have been more than 24 prospective epidemiological primary prevention studies which have shown that HSCRP is useful. Now, these are the different studies, and all studies have, to some extent, consistently shown that it is predictive of first coronary vascular event, HSCRP elevation. Now, these are the trials from 1997 to 2005. They have measured HSCRP levels from less than 1 to more than 3. And increasing HSCRP level consistently has shown increase in vascular events. So HSCRP is quite predictive. Now, it has been shown that HSCRP of more than 2.5 milligram increases the risk 2 to 5-fold in patients of coronary event in patients with angina or healthy normal adults. They can even predict progression in cerebrovascular and peripheral vascular disease. More than 3 milligram, it can predict acute myocardial infarction in patients of unstable angina. It can predict reocclusion in patients of angioplasty. Now, this predictive role is additive and beyond the conventional risk factors. Cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, total cholesterol HDL ratio, HSCRP is more predictive than this and additive to it. In fact, it is useful for both patients with normal cholesterol, normal LDL, as well as high LDL. It is useful and beyond in patients with diabetic metabolic syndrome. So its risk is additive to diabetes metabolic syndrome and even in healthy adults. So if HSCRP is less than 1 milligram, the risk is low. If the HSCRP is between 1 to 3 milligram, it is a moderate risk. If it is more than 3 milligram, it is high risk. If it is more than 10, then be wary. It is not important, because more than 10 milligram means patient has some acute infection, has some acute inflammation, or has acute injury. And you have to repeat the value after 3 weeks. Remember, more than 10 milligram means you have some acute infection. You have to repeat value in 3 weeks. And to know whether it is a response to acute inflammation or otherwise. Now, Jupiter trial created a lot of noise in medical and non-medical media, because this was the first trial which looked at HSCRP levels after treatment with rosuvastatin and its effects on coronary vascular events. And this was the first primary prevention trial which showed that rosuvastatin treatment in patients with elevated HSCRP has brought down the events by 44%. Of course, there were a lot of criticism of this trial. These trials had many drawbacks, and these results were not replicated subsequently. But the message from Jupiter trial was, give statins to all diabetics, give statins if the LDL is more than 160, and give statins to also all who have HSCRP more than 2 milligram. Statins owe their beneficial effects not only to its cholesterol reduction properties, but also to its anti-inflammatory properties, as shown by Jupiter trial, by reduction of HSCRP. And perhaps aspirin also might owe its beneficial effects, besides antiplatelet, to its anti-inflammatory activity. Now, there are very many theories how HSCRP is useful that we won't go into detail, but there are still many issues to be sorted out in HSCRP. These are the issues. There are no firm data to today to that lowering of CRP levels per se will lower vascular risk. Except for Jupiter trial, we don't have any other evidence. And it remains controversial whether CRP plays a direct role in atherogenesis. Now, other important things. Patients who are already at low risk, risk of less than 10% in 10 years, are not going to benefit if hsCRP is high, because we are not going to make them high risk. And so the management is not going to change. Similarly, patients who are at very high risk, more than 20% risk, even if hsCRP is high, their aggressive intensive preventive measures are going to continue. So the real role of hsCRP is in the intermediate group by various risk scores. If the intermediate risk group, that is 10 to 20% by various risk score methods, if the risk is between 10 to 20%, hsCRP might be useful. They might be need more aggressive preventive measures like high-dose statins. The other issues are, there are no secondary preventive measures of proven efficacy should not be dependent on hsCRP levels, and serial testing of hsCRP should not be used to monitor effects of treatment. Coming to the last biomarkers, just a minute or so. Now, natriuretic peptides, these are different natriuretic peptides. Some are restricted to heart, some are in brain. Now, heart failure is a natriuretic peptide deficient, NP deficient state. Yet, NPs are elevated in CHF. So there is a paradox. It is a NP deficient state, still NPs are elevated. This paradox is explained is that either there is end organ resistance to NPs, or the NPs that are there are biologically inactive. Thus, despite elevated NP, natriuretic peptide should increase natriuresis. Despite increased NPs, the expected increased natriuresis is absent in heart failure patients, and there is sodium water retention. Now, this is how they are produced. Both BNP and pro-BNP are useful for clinical and have been shown to be useful for our prognostication. Now, there is not much of a difference between these two, except for the half-life of BNP is slightly less. Anti-pro-BNP half-life is more. Anti-pro-BNP also is more stable than BNP. And the sensitivity and specificity run parallel in both BNP and anti-pro-BNP. Now, these are the cutoff values for BNP and anti-pro-BNP. If you want to rule out heart failure, BNP value, if it is less than 100, you virtually rule out heart failure. A patient who presents with dyspnea in emergency department, you want to know whether it is a cardiac dyspnea or non-cardiac dyspnea. If the value is less than 100, you virtually rule out a cardiac dyspnea or a heart failure. If it is more than 500, it is cardiac dyspnea is more likely. NT-proBNP value slightly varies with age, but if it is less than 300, you rule out cardiac cause as a dyspnea. Now, there are a whole lot of other conditions which might elevate or reduce NT-proBNP. Now, NT-proBNP has a very good prognostic role and is linearly related to both BNP and NT-proBNP, to in-hospital mortality as well as one-year mortality. It correlates with New York Heart Association class. As New York Heart Association class increases, BNP levels increase. It also correlates with heart failure as assessed by echocardiography. Now, patients with normal ejection fraction, no heart failure, BNP levels are low. With diastolic heart failure, BNP levels are slightly more. With systolic dysfunction, BNP levels are much more. They are the highest. What is more important is this slide is very important. The predictive value of BNP is beyond ejection fraction. This is very important slide. You see, now these are the different levels of BNP. 135 is the lowest level, 450, 1260. At any ejection fraction, it is not the ejection fraction which predicts all-cause mortality. It is BNP. Means even if ejection fraction is 70 and BNP is high, all-cause mortality is high. Even if the ejection fraction is only 20 and the BNP is low, the mortality is less. So it is not ejection fraction which predicts the mortality, but it is a BNP level which predicts the mortality. So it is more and beyond the value predicted by ejection fraction. Now, this is another interesting slide. Now, you have a patient who is admitted with heart failure. You have three patients. One, the BNP was highest on admission, and its percent change at the time of discharge is maximum. This patient had a high BNP, but its lowest pre-discharge BNP. And this patient had a marginal change during hospitalization. So this is at hospitalization, this is at discharge. Now, which of these patients is going to have best prognosis? Now, this was studied, the pre-discharge BNP levels. Pre-discharge BNP levels. The patients who have lowest pre-discharge BNP have the best prognosis. So it is not how high the BNP was at admission, but what is the BNP level at discharge? It is predictive of long-term prognosis. So when do you measure BNP? You measure BNP at the time of discharge or later. So later is the better. So this is a recommendation. During a heart failure hospitalization, a pre-discharge natural peptide can be useful to establish post-discharge prognosis. Now, whether anti-proBNP guided therapy is useful, it has been shown in this trial, if you bring down BNP to less than 1,000, the prognosis is better. Also, NP-guided therapy is better than standard of care therapy. But meta-analysis is somewhat ambiguous. You don't have a proof yet that you make, what do you do? Is suppose you have high BNP, you adjust their diuretics, adjust their ACE inhibitors, adjust their beta blockers, and see if you can bring down the BNP levels and the overall long-term life expectancy is increased. So meta-analysis is slightly ambiguous. But the summary is, there is little difference between BNP and NT-proBNP. It is useful for diagnosis of heart failure in patients with dyspnea, useful for prognosis and risk stratification, and it may be useful for therapy guidance. Thank you.